Hello to all and welcome back to Should You Get? I'm Brandon Templar and I hope you like the new quality of the videos on this channel. You see, as of just the other day, I decided that I would get some half-decent recording software, which I think looks significantly better, and also will now record at 60 frames per second rather than my old 30, so hopefully the quality of my videos will increase dramatically. And I thought to myself, what aircraft should I use to firstly show off my amazing new recording software? And I thought, for a powerful software, I'll get a powerful aircraft, as we look at the Stirling Mark I. Now, this aircraft is often referred to as the most overpowered aircraft in the game, but enough on that for now, and let's get on to the history of the Stirling and what makes it such a legendary bomber in War Thunder. The Short Stirling was the first four-engined British heavy bomber. Designed by the Short brothers to meet an Air Ministry specification from 1936, the Stirling was ordered for the RAF after the preferred design from the Supermarine had to be abandoned. Now, during the 1930s, the Royal Air Force was interested primarily in twin-engine bombers. These designs put limited demand on engine production and maintenance. However, it soon became apparent that having only two engines on heavy bombers offered massive power limitations. These limitations were so serious that the RAF had to invest heavily in the development of huge engines, such as their 2,000 horsepower class engines and others of the sort. By the late 1930s, none of the twin-engine heavy bomber designs were ready for production. However, the US and USSR were developing similar heavy bombers with four smaller engines rather than the British two large engines. Now, these other bombers proved to have excellent range and fair lifting capacity, so in 1936, the RAF also decided to investigate the feasibility of the four-engined bomber. However, the specification the Air Ministry gave had several requirements. The bomb load was to be a maximum of 14,000 pounds and carried to a range of 2,000 miles, or a lesser payload of 8,000 pounds to 3,000 miles. It is also worth noting that for its era, this was incredibly demanding. Furthermore, it had to cruise at 230 or more miles per hour and have three gun turrets, one in the nose, one in the middle, and one in the rear. Not only this, but the aircraft also had to be able to transport at least 24 soldiers and to be able to use a catapult assistance for takeoff. The reason behind this was that it would be able to fly troops to the far corners of the British Empire and then support them with bombing. Now, the Short brothers were one of the many companies asked to make said design, the reason being because they already had four-engine flying boats, the one you may know better as the S-25 Sunderland. And indeed, you'll notice that there are a lot of similarities between the Sunderland and the Stirling. I guess the Short brothers thought, well, why fix what isn't broken? And indeed, all they did was make the engines more powerful, slightly change the fuselage, and add some wheels to it so it can land on airfields, and make it so it has a lot larger bomb load to meet the specification. This new design was at the time called only the S-29. It was a test model, if you will, and was criticised in February 1937 by the Air Ministry. However, this criticism did come with some means of constructiveness to it, as it was suggested that modifications to the original Short design, such as considering the Bristol Hercules engines as an alternative to the Napier Dagger inlines, and increasing the service ceiling to 28,000 foot by reducing the wingspan of the aircraft. The Shaw brothers accepted this advice, and the first S-29, now given the service name Stirling after the Scottish city, flew on the 14th of May 1939 with four Bristol Hercules II radial engines. The Stirling itself entered service in early 1941, but had a relatively brief operational career as a bomber, the main problems with it being that it simply wasn't as good as the Halifax or Lancaster bombers, and it was relegated to second line duties from 1943. So I just want you to remember that, entered service in 1941, and left service as a bomber in 1943, okay? Right. So, how well does the Stirling perform in War Thunder? I mean, the aircraft itself only fought until 1943, and I'm happy to say that the Stirling is in fact the most overpowered aircraft in the game, often coming up against late props, early jets, late jets, and beyond. It seems to beat all of them with absolutely no problems. In fact, it's so overpowered that I wouldn't even say it deserves to go up in the battle ratings. In fact, what it needs to do is to join its own battle rating. Battle rating Stirling. And this battle rating will only consist of Stirling bombers, because of course it's so overpowered that only one aircraft can beat a Stirling, and that's of course a Stirling. But then again, in saying that, surely it's like the old saying of what happens if an unstoppable object hits an immovable object. Maybe a black hole, I don't know. But either way, this aircraft is completely overpowered and honestly probably just needs to be taken out of the game full stop. I mean, I can't believe that it's only a 5.0 battle rating in general. I mean, it's so overpowered that everything it comes up against is a win after a win. I mean, I cannot tell you the amount of times that I have won games with ease thanks to the massive firepower of the four 303 rounds at a 5.0 battle rating. They are just completely overpowered. There is no aircraft in this game that could shoot down such a glorious craft that is the Stirling. And indeed, I think that this aircraft is so overpowered that we need to start a petition right here, right now, to get the Stirling banned, because it's just ruining the game for everyone else. I mean, imagine you're flying one of your N-tier props or whatever, and you come up against a Stirling. What do? Well, naturally, you'll either run away, turn off your computer, throw your computer out of the window, run into the corner of your room, and maybe curl into a ball and start crying to yourself. Because let's face it, the Stirling is just too overpowered, and we all know it, so we need to act now if we are to stop the Stirling menace from taking over the War Thunder servers. Although you got to admit, that was a pretty epic death. I mean, seconds before hitting the ground, I set the Spitfire on fire before I blow up. I mean, that's like that old War Thunder promotional video, you know, this one.
There's a beast deep inside you. It will not die. It will fight back.
Wow, and there's me thinking those videos were really unrealistic and didn't actually show what really went on in War Thunder. Well, that is true, but for this one-off occasion they were actually right, so, who knew? And I digress, because, well, I can't make this joke any longer. The Stirling is so bad. I mean, everything about it is wrong for its battle rating. I mean, the aircraft itself isn't even bad. It's okay speed-wise, its turning isn't the worst, and its armament, you know, is okay. But it's a 5.0 battle rating aircraft, and it just is so badly positioned at its current battle rating that everyone, I think, at this point who's ever flown this knows how absolutely useless it is at its battle rating, and, well, of course I'm no different. But I thought rather than saying everything that's wrong about this aircraft at a 5.0 battle rating, because we'd be here for bloody hours, I decided I'd talk about an aircraft that's at a 4.0 battle rating, and yet is somehow almost superior than the Stirling in every way. This aircraft, of course, being the Halifax Mark III. So, as you can see, the Stirling is a 5.0 battle rating and the Halifax is a 4, so you'd imagine that the Stirling would be an entire battle rating better than the Halifax, right? Well, no, not at all, and all you have to do is look at the stats to see that for yourself. I mean, as you can clearly see, the Halifax is faster, it has a better turn time, it has a better climb rate, and has overall better guns and armament. The Stirling having 4 through 3s at the rear and 2 on the dorsal turret, when the Halifax has 4 on the rear and 4 on the dorsal turret. And yes, I know that the Stirling has 2 on the front and the Halifax only has 1, but that is completely irrelevant. Like, whoever uses their front turret on their bomber, no one. So, you know. But even if you do include that, then the Stirling is still down a gun. So, like what I've been saying, all in all, the Halifax is better in every single way. But surely the Stirling's got to win on something, right? Maybe a bomb load? I mean, surely it has the bigger bomb load, right? Well, no, actually. You see, although it is technically true that the Stirling has the highest bomb capacity, it's holding 27 500-pound bombs when the Halifax can only hold 15 500-pound bombs. But in saying that, it loses on explosive mass, which is probably more important if you ask me. You see, the maximum explosive mass a Stirling can have is 9 1,000-pound bombs, when the Halifax has 9 1,000-pound bombs and 6 500-pound bombs, so it can't even win at that. So this brings us back to the main question, which is, why is it a 5.0 battle rating aircraft? And the simple answer is, I don't know. I literally cannot wrap my head around why this is a 5.0, but something like the Halifax is a 4.0. It literally makes no sense, and I cannot get my head around it. I mean, the only one reason I can come up with so far is the reason why it's still at a 5.0 is so then it can keep the gap between the Lancaster and the Halifax. You see, maybe Ganjin wanted there to be a constant amount of bombers all the way down, rather than them all stopping at a 4.0 and then starting again at a 5.7 for the Lancaster. But that's not an excuse, that's literally just like Ganjin logic that I wouldn't be surprised if they were stupid enough to implement. Oh, and yes, I do know that was a terrible miss on the carrier. I was being rushed by enemy fighters, I couldn't think straight, and I only missed by a little bit, so I do get a little bit of credit, maybe. I don't know. But either way, the Stirling horror story continues further still. You see, the problem is with the Stirling is that it will fight aircraft as high as 6.0 battle rating aircraft, and the Mark III can fight things as high as 6.3 battle rating aircraft. And you know what that means. It means that the Stirling has to come up against aircraft such as the LA-9, the TA-152C3, the DO-335A1, the J-7W1 Shinden, and the KI-83. What delightful aircraft to come up against, I'm sure you'll agree. And it gets better still, because do you remember when I said that the Stirling was introduced in 1941 and was retired by 1943 as a main bombing role? Well, it turns out that all five of these aircraft were designed either 1944 or later. And here's an even more interesting fact, the LA-9 I mentioned was invented in 1946, meaning that it was actually invented post-Second World War. And does anyone remember a similar event that happened a couple of years back on War Thunder, where the Wellington Mark 10 was, I believe, the aircraft that was at a 5.0 battle rating, Tier 3? Anyone else remember that? It's very interesting how they seem to have somehow done it again. Talk about not learning from your mistakes, guys. I mean, come on. Which brings us on to the next question of where should it be on the battle rating? And indeed, it's not a Wellington Mark 10, it's nowhere near as bad, so it won't go to a 3.3. But at the same time, it's not much better than a Halifax. So, if you ask me, I say putting it at a 3.7 battle rating and then putting the Mark 3 Sterling at a 4.0 would be probably the most competitive thing to do. And also, by doing this, I would also recommend putting the Sterling before the Halifax on the tech tree, because not only was the Halifax made after the Sterling, it's also better than the Sterling. But, you know, once again, Gaijin, that's only logic. You know, we all know very well that you don't listen to any of that, so there you go. Which brings us to the final question of the night, which is, should you get the Sterling Mark 1? Well, do I even need to say it? No, of course not. It's terrible at its battle rating, and it needs to be put down dramatically. I mean, I love the Sterling. The Sterling was revolutionary. It's a great British icon, and I absolutely adore the aircraft. But on War Thunder, it's a joke, to say the very least. And I'd even go as far as say it's a little bit insulting at its current battle rating. And in fact, I would say the Sterling is the second most underpowered aircraft in War Thunder. That's right, second. But what is more underpowered than the Sterling, I hear you ask? Surely nothing could be more underpowered than the Sterling. He's the Sterling, for God's sake. But I actually believe, from my personal experience, there is something worse. And what is it? Well, I say tune in next time on Should You Get for the worst aircraft, in my opinion and experience, on War Thunder. So until then, I say I thank you very much for watching, and until next time, I'll see you then. Ah yes, the German aces. Best in the world, I hear. God almighty.